गुड इवनिंग, नमस्ते।
हेलो वंस अगेन, गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी। माय नेम इज डॉक्टर जीपी नायक, प्रोफेसर ऑफ ह्यूमन रिसोर्स मैनेजमेंट एंड प्रिंसिपल कंसल्टेंट एट टैलेंट एवेन्यूज। द पर्पस ऑफ टुडेज सेमिनार इज टू अंडरस्टैंड द लॉ रिलेटिंग टू लेऑफ, रिट्रेंचमेंट, ट्रांसफर ऑफ ओनरशिप एंड क्लोजर ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियल एस्टैब्लिशमेंट्स, पर्टिकुलरली इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द पास्ट 2 months of challenges the industries have been facing. I am thankful that this program is sponsored by M&HR Solutions Private Limited, Bangalore. Now I will straight away go into the subject. Before going into the subject, you have been monitoring the various circulars and instructions issued by the government during the past 2 or 2.5 months under the National Disaster Management Act. Now, whether any of those government orders have mentioned that you should not retrench workers or you should not
Sir, now you have
for the interruption.
Sir, can you able to
hear? Now, during the past 2.5 months, have you come across any government orders under the National Disaster Management Act that you should not lay off your employees, or that you should not retrench your employees, or you should not transfer the ownership of your business, or you should not close down your industrial establishment? The only instruction that you have received so far from the government orders is that you should not remove anyone from service, you should not reduce the salary of any employees, and you should continue to pay them salary during this lockdown period. Therefore, today's discussion is very important in order to understand from the perspective of the industries who have got different challenges, like they are no more in a position to continue, or the industries who are in a position to hand over this organization to somebody else, either permanently or temporarily. Or let us say there are industries who would not be able to pay the salaries at least for next 2 to 3 months. Okay, so considering all these aspects, today's seminar will enable you people to learn the legal aspects of layoff and retrenchment of workmen, as well as transfer of ownership and closure of industrial establishments. All these legal aspects are given in the Industrial Disputes Act 1947, which is a central act applicable all over the country. The learning objectives of this seminar is to understand the meaning and significance of layoff, retrenchment, closure, and transfer of industrial undertaking under the Industrial Disputes Act, and to know the lawful methods of layoff, retrenchment, closure, and transfer, to avoid the costly errors in doing layoff, retrenchment, closure, and transfer, and to make positive difference to your organization and its business goals. See, the term layoff is quite confused in a country like India. Why? It is because most often newspapers in India report that so-and-so company is laying up 100 workers. Okay, because the word layoff in Western countries, particularly in American countries, layoff means removing an employee from service or terminating an employee from service, which is not the case in India. Here, the meaning of layoff is something else. Okay, it is not termination of employee service, rather it is a temporary refusal of employment by the employer to any number of employees due to specific reasons. What are those specific reasons? We are going to discuss later. Therefore, as per legal definition, the employee-employer relation continues and the employee will be still in the service of your employer during the layoff in India. Now look at the definition of layoff under the Industrial Disputes Act. Section 2KKK, triple K of the Industrial Dispute Act defines layoff as under. What does it say? Layoff means the failure or refusal or inability of an employer on account of shortage of coal, shortage of power or raw materials or the accumulation of stocks or the breakdown of machinery or the natural calamity or for any other connected reasons. So due to any of these reasons or any other connected reasons, it is the refusal or inability of an employer to give employment to any number of persons temporarily. Okay. Now, for that, these employees' names should be in the muster roll of the industrial establishment. And these are the employees who have not yet been terminated or retrenched yet from these services. So this makes it clear that layoff in India does not mean termination from service. Layoff in India means temporary refusal of employment by employer to any number of workmen due to specific reasons like shortage of coal, shortage of power, shortage of electricity, or huge stock of inventory. Are the lawful layoff under the Industrial Disputes Act. You have to understand here, in a country like India, managerial employees are not protected by any law as regards layoff. It means if they are managerial employees, that is executive and above category or officer and above category, and even if the supervisors are drawing salary more than 10,000 rupees per month, they also come under the non-workman category as per the Industrial Dispute Act. So in their case, you can lay off without paying any layoff compensation or without even seeking permission or without even intimating the government. Only in respect of the workman category of employees, you have to follow the procedure given in the Industrial Disputes Act. Okay, so this law relating to layoff is given in chapter 5A, it is written as V-A. You have to read it as 5A. As well as in chapter 5B of the Industrial Disputes Act. Okay. So, in order to understand the provisions of chapter 5B, you have to start with 5A only. So, therefore, let us start with chapter 5A. In chapter 5A, sections 25A, 25B, 25C, 25D, and 25E deals with layoff. Okay. So, for the purpose of these sections, or for the purpose of layoff under chapter 5A, industrial establishment is defined here. Of course, here it is a very limited or narrow definition, but this is how they have defined. Okay. So, here the definition limits the industrial establishments to only factories, mines, plantations, and then there is another limitation in terms of the number of employees. Factories, mines, or plantations employing more than 50 and less than 100 workmen. What does this mean? The factories, mines, and plantations employing more than 100 workmen are covered under Chapter 5B. In respect of some other states like Maharashtra, Rajasthan, and even Madhya Pradesh, the state governments during the past 5 years have made some amendments under which they have increased this 100 number to 300. So up to 300 workmen, it comes under Chapter 5A, and above 300, it goes to Chapter 5B. Okay, but in Karnataka, since I am speaking right here from Bangalore in Karnataka, the 100 number remains valid even now. But what are the exceptions to the previous slide? The lab layup is not applicable to factories, mines, and plantations employing less than 50 workmen. This is applicable all over the country. It is not applicable to other industrial establishments like information technology companies, commercial markets like your retail malls, transport undertakings, shops, or any other commercial establishments, hospitality industry like hotels. So for none of those other industrial establishments, the layup provisions given here are not at all applicable. It means in all such industrial establishments, layup can be given without following the provisions of above sections. I mean, you don't have to give any notice. You don't have to give any layup compensation. There is no limit on only 45 days of layup. You can give layup as and when you want for as many days as you wish. There are further exceptions. The layup provisions under Chapter 5A are not applicable to workmen of industrial establishment which are of seasonal character. What is this seasonal character or industry of intermittent nature? You know, take good example is sugar industry. Sugar industry in many parts of the country do not work throughout the year. Rather, they work on the part of the year, let us say 6 to 7 months or maximum 8 to 9 months in a year. Okay. For such seasonal industries, the layup provisions are not applicable. It means seasonal industries can lay up their workmen. Of course, there is another provision for the seasonal industries. They have to pay retainer allowance equivalent to 50% for the employees for as long as they don't provide employment, which is not part of our discussion here. But as regards layup, for seasonal industries, the layup provisions are not applicable, so the workers of seasonal industries can be laid off without paying layup compensation. Then, to workmen who are in casual or badly employment, I hope most of you understand the meaning of casual or badly employment. The casual employee is the one whose nature of work is not regular in nature. Okay, once in a while, once in a month, probably let us say, someone has to clean your sump tank in the factory or someone has to clean your septic tank once in 2 months. So he's a casual worker. As and when there is a work once in 2 months or once in a month, you will call him. Otherwise, you are not going to call him. Badly workman is a one who is employed in place of a regular workman. When badly workman is on leave or badly workman is on, absent. So for them also, the layup provisions are not applicable. And to workmen who have not rendered at least 1 year continuous service as on the date of layup, let us say you want to declare layup from tomorrow, and out of 100 employees, at least 25 employees have not completed at least 1 year service because they have been hired just about 6 or 7 months back. For them also, layup provisions are not applicable. It means you can lay them off without paying layup compensation. Now, what is the compensation that you have to pay? During the period of layup, the employer shall pay 50% of the basic wages and DNS allowance to laid off workman as layup compensation. Here, what is to be payable is specifically given. Here, don't take average pay or basic pay or grass pay and so on. Here they have specifically said that during the period of layup, employer shall pay 50% of basic wages and DNS allowance only to the laid off workman as layup compensation. It is called as layup compensation. lab compensation is not payable for the days of weekly holidays. Let us say in a month, there are four weekly holidays. Generally, most of the companies give Sunday as a weekly holiday. It could be some other day also, but generally it is 4 to 5 days. So for weekly holidays, you don't have to give layoff compensation. Other than weekly holidays, let us say in a month, if there are 30 days, let us assume there are 4 or 5 weekly holidays. For the remaining 25 days, you have to give layoff compensation at the rate of 50% of the basic wages and BNS allowances. Other allowances are not to be paid. But for how long you can give layoff compensation? Layoff compensation in a year can be given up to 45 days. And after 45 days, you have the option. If you have money, you can pay. But as HR manager, you are also responsible for saving the money of your organization. Therefore, what I would like to suggest you is, after 45 days, if the layoff has to continue, either you can enter into an agreement with the workman to continue the layoff without paying compensation after 45 days, that is from 46th day. Or at the end of 45 days, if your business conditions have not improved, then you can very well terminate them from service. Terminate, I mean, retrench them from service. So, as I said, after 45 days of layoff, the employer has the option to retrench the laid off workman in accordance with Section 25F of Industrial Disputes Act. We are going to see very soon what does 25F of Industrial Disputes Act says. In such a case, the layoff compensation already paid can be adjusted towards the retrenchment compensation. Let us say you may have paid for the past 45 days the retrenchment compensation to the extent of 50% of the basic wages and BNS allowance. Such an amount can be adjusted at the end of 45 days if you decide to retrench them from service. Retrenchment means terminating them from service or permanently removing them from service. There are certain circumstances under which the layoff compensation is not required to be payable. Which are they? If the workman refuses to accept alternative employment in the same establishment, let us say there is a turner or fitter in your organization, and due to various challenges that you have been facing, the turner or fitter does not have work for next 2 or 3 months. So during this period, you want to offer them some other work. Let us say you want them to work as an electrician, or you want to work them as an assistant, or you want to work them as in the time office. But the worker refuses to accept alternative employment. So you, as an employer, you may offer him employment in the same establishment or in another establishment or another industry or another factory of the same employer within 5 kilometer radius. It could be distance or radius. Let us say within 5 kilometers radius of the same place, you have another factory or another office where you offered him employment, and he refuses. The only condition to these alternative employment is the alternative employment does not call for special skill or expertise. Let us say for a fitter or turner, you assign the work of, let us say, a vehicle driver. So generally, he may not be knowing how to drive a vehicle, whether it is light vehicle or commercial vehicle. In such a case, it will not be valid. And when you offer alternative employment, you should not reduce his salary or benefits. So whatever, you have to tell him that whatever salary and benefit that you have been getting in the existing employment, you will continue to get it. And I am going to post you to a job for which special skills are not required. You can do this work. There are few more conditions to get layoff compensation. If the laid off workman does not present himself for work at the establishment at the appointed time and at least once in a day and mark his attendance. So every day the laid off worker has to report for this thing work in the factory entrance, and then there will be a muster roll which the employer is required to maintain. There he has to sign, and let us say he may wait up to about 2 hours, and if employer is not able to provide him employment, he can go back and he is entitled for the layoff compensation. Second condition, if the layoff is due to strike or slowing down of production by workmen in another part of the establishment, in such a case also layoff compensation is not payable. Most often HR managers do not use this provision. See, one of the departments is under strike or slowing down of production. Why it happens? In some companies, there are multiple unions. And the members of a particular union are predominant in certain sections or certain departments. So therefore, what happens in such a case? Due to union rivalry, the workers of a particular union who are predominantly concentrated in a particular department, they will slow down or they go on strike. So, you know the this thing, assembly line. If the other departments do not move their parts or move their this thing, production, the next departments or next unit cannot perform. So, in such a situation, you can declare a layoff without paying compensation. Okay, so this is all about layoff under Chapter 5A of the Industrial Disputes Act. After some time, again we are going to study layoff under Chapter 5B of the Industrial Disputes Act. Now we will move on to the next topic, that is retrenchment under Chapter 5A of Industrial Disputes Act. As regards retrenchment under Chapter 5A, there is only one section, that is Section 25 of Industrial Disputes Act. So here, I want you people to understand the meaning of retrenchment. I'm sure most of you are aware, but those of you who are not aware, I want to tell you. The word retrenchment in India, as per Industrial Dispute Act, is nothing but termination of service of a workman by the employer for any reason other than the reason of indiscipline or misconduct. Please remember, let us say you find some employee committing misconduct, you cannot give him retrenchment. See, what you have to do if there is a case of indiscipline, you have to issue him a charge sheet, conduct the inquiry. If the allegations are proved, then you have to punish him with dismissal or some other punishment. You cannot give him retrenchment. But in all other cases, for any other reasons, you can very well retrench a workman. Okay, retrenchment means termination of service or permanently removing an employee from service. Therefore, retrenchment permanently ends the employer-employee relation. Whereas in case of layoff that we discussed, employer-employee relation remains. It is only a temporary refusal of employment by the employer to any number of employees under layoff. But here it is not the case. Retrenchment means permanently you are ending the employer-employee relation. The moment you issue the retrenchment order to the employee, he will not be your employee anymore from tomorrow. Okay. Retrenchment in factories, mines and plantations employing more than 100 workmen is governed by Chapter 5B, which we are going to discuss later on. What is retrenchment? Industrial Dispute Act has defined. You have to see Section 200. It is not 00. Section 200, small OOs. Section 200 of Industrial Dispute Act defines retrenchment as the termination by the employer of the service of a workman. It could be one workman or a number of workmen for any reasons whatsoever, otherwise then as a punishment inflicted by way of disciplinary action. But it does not include voluntary retirement of the workman or retirement of the workman on reaching the age of superannuation. Further, it does not include, further retrenchment does not include termination as a result of non-renewal of the contract of employment between the employer and the workman concerned. And then termination of service of a workman on the ground of continued ill health. Okay. So under any of these provisions, it cannot be treated as retrenchment. Therefore, you need not have to pay the retrenchment compensation. Now, what does Section 25F of the Chapter 5A talk about the compensation payable to the retrenched workman? One more important thing you have to understand in the retrenchment is, in layoff, we had a very narrow definition of what is an industry. What I had told you, in case of layoff, industry means a factory or a plantation or a mine employing more than 50 workmen and less than 100 workmen. And I also said, in respect of factory, mine or plantation employing more than 100 workmen, there will be a separate chapter called Chapter 5B. Okay. So therefore, here we are focusing only on Chapter 5A, but the definition of industrial establishment for the purpose of retrenchment is quite wide. It is not narrow. Okay, it is the full definition as given in Section 2KA, small k, small a, of the Industrial Dispute Act. It means all industrial establishments, including shops or commercial establishments, are included. There is no limit on the number of workmen employed, except those covered under Section 5B. It means under Industrial Disputes Act, even an establishment having just two or three employees or one employee, that is also an industrial establishment. And if you are retrenching or removing one employee from your organization, still the retrenchment provision is applicable to you. There are certain conditions prior to implementing retrenchment under Chapter 5A. The employer should give 1 month's advance notice to the concerned workman with reasons for retrenchment, or the employer should pay 1 month's wages in lieu of notice period, and the employer also should pay retrenchment compensation equivalent to 15 days average pay for every completed year of service or any part exceeding 6 months. Here, what I want you people to understand is, in the case of layoff, what is to be payable was defined. That is, 50% of the DMS allowance and basic wages was to be payable. But here, the retrenchment compensation, they have not specifically mentioned basic pay and DMS allowance. Rather, the word used here is 15 days of average pay for every completed year of service. Average pay is again defined under the Industrial Disputes Act, right in Section 2. If the workman is eligible for higher compensation under any contract or any settlement, he shall get the higher benefits. Let us say you may have entered into a settlement with your union stating that for those who are going to be retrenched, will be paid more. Then you have to pay more. Or if there are any other contract at the time of employment, if you have agreed to such a condition, then you have to pay more to them. So prior to retrenchment, there are few more conditions. You have to give notice to the government also, that is giving notice to the labor department of the government. To be eligible for notice and retrenchment compensation, the concerned workman should have been in continuous employment under the employer for at least 1 year. It means the employees who have not completed 1 year service need not have to be paid retrenchment compensation. They can be very well removed from service. Just a minute, please excuse me. Okay, the procedure for retrenchment is given in section 25G as well as in 25H. What these procedures basically are: if the workmen to be retrenched are indigent Indian citizens, the employer should retrench the junior most employee first, junior most workman first, using the last come first go principle. Please remember this. See, generally what we do as HR managers, when we plan a retrenchment, we generally target the senior employees by assuming that senior employees are lazy, their salaries are more, their productivity is less, therefore senior employees should be removed first. But government thinks otherwise. Government believes that a junior employee, if removed from service, can very well get employment elsewhere, whereas a senior employee, if retrenched from service, will be finding very difficult to get another employment. Therefore, the government rule says under section 25G of Industrial Disputes Act that the junior most employees should be retrenched first. In that order, the junior most will go first, then the next junior most will go first, like that. The above principle can be waived if there is an agreement between the employer and the workman to be retrenched. Now, there is a possibility here. Let us say there are 100 employees, out of which you don't want to remove the 20 junior most employees for your own reasons. You believe that they are very flexible, they are hardworking, they are very productive, they are quite disciplined, all that. And at the same time, some of the senior employees want to leave. They are no more interested to work. They say, sir, if you give us some money, some compensation, we will be very happy to leave the organization. In such a case, you can enter into an agreement with a senior employee and retain the junior employee and retrench the senior employee. The second procedure that you have to understand is section 25H. Once you carry out the retrenchment, thereafter, if you want to hire new employees, you should give preference to the retrenched workers who are already removed from service, provided they are Indian citizens. So, section 25G as well as section 25H are to be applied only if you were retrenched employees are Indian citizens. Let us say retrenched employees are foreign citizens, you don't have to follow them. I think there are some questions. Let me see if I have to answer right now. Yeah, there are few questions. We will definitely take all the questions. Okay, so till now we have learnt the layoff as well as retrenchment under Chapter 5A of the Industrial Disputes Act. And now let us move on to the next topic, that is transfer of ownership of industrial establishments under Chapter 5A of the Industrial Disputes Act. Section 25FF deals with double F, 25FF deals with transfer of ownership of industrial undertaking. Accordingly, the workmen who are in continuous service for at least 1 year under the same employer are eligible to notice and compensation as per Section 25A as if they were retrenched. So here you are not retrenching the worker. You are not removing any workers from service, but you are selling your business. You are handing over the ownership of your business to somebody else, some other promoter, some other capitalist. In such a case, the existing employees are entitled for layoff compensation. Entitled for retrenchment compensation as if they are removed from service. Here also, the definition of industrial establishment is wide as given in Section 2KA of Industrial Dispute Act. It means it is large. IT companies are included, hospitality companies are included, transport organizations are included. You name any industrial establishment, everything is included under Section 2KA of the Industrial Disputes Act. Here, there is no need to give intimation or notice to the labor department when you want to transfer the ownership of your organization to another person or another promoter. Again, I'm telling you, factories, mines, and plantation employing more than 100 workmen will be governed by Chapter 5B, but there is a mistake here. I want to remove this because transfer of ownership of industrial establishment is covered only in Chapter 5A of the Industrial Disputes Act, and it is not given in Chapter 5B of the Industrial Disputes Act. So therefore, I am going to remove this right now. There are certain circumstances in which the retrenchment compensation is not payable to the workers when you go for transfer of ownership from one owner to another owner, and those circumstances are as under. If the service of workman has not been interrupted by such transfer, it means he will continue to get same salary. He will continue to do same kind of work. His working hours remains the same. Virtually, there is no change in the service conditions of the concerned workman. Second, if the service conditions of such workman after the transfer are not less favorable, it means he will continue to get same salary. The first point is service conditions are not interrupted. Interrupted means there is a continuity of service. Let us say worker has completed 10 years of service, and today you are selling your business to a new promoter. So it should not so happen the new promoter issue him a new appointment order and say that you are no more my old employee, from today you are the new employee, and for whatever service you have rendered during the past 10 years, I have got nothing to do with that. He cannot say that. So when you transfer your business organization to another promoter, another owner, it is your duty as a HR manager to guide your management that in the transfer agreement, we have to make sure to add these things that the future employer, new employer, will continue the service for the purpose of retrenchment, even for the purpose of gratuity. Let us say after 10 years, he removes people from service. Who will pay his gratuity for the past 10 years and the future 10 years. Okay. So all these things you have to make sure as a HR professional that they are added in the agreement that you sign for the transfer of ownership. Under the terms of transfer, the new employer agrees that in the event of future retrenchment, he will pay retrenchment compensation as if the service was uninterrupted. That is, the new employer says that in the event of retrenchment in future, I am going to pay retrenchment compensation even for the past service rendered under the previous employer. Now, so far we have discussed about layoff, retrenchment, then transfer of ownership, and now we have come to closure of industrial undertaking under Chapter 5A of the Industrial Disputes Act. So here, Section 25FFA, double F plus A, and Section 25FFF, triple F, of the Chapter 5A. Closure is defined in Section 2CC, small c, double C. 2C, so what does Section 2CC says? Closure means the permanent closing down of a place of employment or a part of the place of employment. Okay, it could be full closure of the place of employment or a partial close of the place of employment. It means, what do you mean by partial closure? You are closing the workplace does not mean you are physically locking down the workplace. You are saying, let us say, out of 1,000 employees, I am going to retain 700 employees and say one or two departments, I don't want to run them, I want to outsource them. Therefore, I am going to close down only those particular departments. Therefore, I do not require the remaining 300 employees. I will retain 700 employees and I will run my company. And one or two departments, I am outsourcing. So the outsourcing agency is carrying out this work in their own premises. Therefore, I do not require these 300 employees of particular departments. Okay. So according to Section 25 FFA, the employer shall give at least 60 days advance notice to the government by stating the specific reason for closure. So here for closure, the employer has to give at least 60 days advance notice to the government by stating the specific reasons for closure. It is only notice, please remember. You are not seeking government's permission for closure under Chapter 5A. You are only giving a notice or an intimation to the government, that is Labor Department of the government, by stating that from so-and-so date, I am going to close down my industry due to following reasons. But there are certain exceptions. The above notice is not required in case of industrial establishments having less than 50 workmen. It means if your organization has less than 50 workmen, then you don't have to give notice to the government for closing down of your industrial establishment. 60 days advance notice to government is also not required if you are a construction industry. The industries which are into building bridges, building roads, or building any other activities, for them also, this notice of 60 days to the government is not required to close down your industrial establishment. Under Section 25FFA, the government has also got powers to waive the requirement of the 60 days advance notice in exceptional circumstances. What do you mean by exceptional circumstances? The Industrial Dispute Act has given one or two instances as exceptional circumstances. They are death of the owner of the organization or fire or any major accident in the industrial establishment. So in such exceptional circumstances, the government may waive the requirement of advance notice of 60 days before closure. Now, when you close down your establishment, so I have already told you under Chapter 5A, you just have to send an intimation or no advance notice to the government, and you are not seeking permission from the government. Is that clear? So therefore, when you are closing down any industrial establishment, the workmen who are in continuous service for at least 1 year are eligible for notice and compensation in accordance with Section 25F. What is Section 25F, which we have already discussed? Section 25F deals with retrenchment. So if you are retrenching someone, you have to give 1 month's advance notice under Chapter 5A. When we go to Chapter 5B, the rules are different. So under Chapter 5A, to retrench a workman, you have to give 1 month's advance notice or 1 month's salary in lieu of advance notice. And then retrenchment compensation at the rate of 15 days average wages for every completed year of service or any period in excess of 6 months. There are instances in which the compensation can be reduced. That is, where the establishment is closed due to unavoidable reasons beyond the control of employer. The total compensation payable shall not exceed 3 months' average pay. Now, you tell me, what is the unavoidable reasons beyond the control of employer? Again, the Industrial Dispute Act has clearly said unavoidable circumstances are not that you are incurring loss, or there is huge pile of inventory, or there is no demand for your goods, or you are not getting any new orders. No, they are not. Or you are continuously incurring loss. The Industrial Dispute Act does not consider them as unavoidable circumstances. Unavoidable circumstances are reasons, could be earthquake, or let us say volcano, tsunami, or let us say situations like your COVID. Okay, so such unavoidable reasons, when you are closing down your organization, then the total compensation payable shall not exceed 3 months' average pay. It means the worker may have rendered 25 years of service. So for 25 years of service, at the rate of 15 days salary for every completed year of service, how much you would have paid? You would have ideally paid 12 months salary. That is, 15 days salary for 25 years becomes 12 months salary. But here, due to unavoidable reasons beyond the control of employer, you are closing down. Therefore, you can close the matter by just paying 3 months average salary. In certain instances of closure, you need not have to pay the compensation. Which are they? In case of a mine, if the mine is closed due to exhaustion of minerals and the employer offers job in another mine with similar service conditions, you have a mine operating and their minerals are no more available. When minerals are no more available, as an employer, you have offered employment to your employees in another mine with similar service condition. You are saying that same working hour, same salary, same benefits. So there is no mineral here. Let us go to another mine. The services of such workmen is not interrupted due to such relocation. As an employer, you are also saying that, okay, you have already worked for 10 years in this mine and now you are going to work in the new mine. So whatever service you have already rendered will be taken into account for future terminal benefits, including retrenchment compensation or gratuity for that matter. Therefore, please come and join in the new place. In the event of future retrenchment, the employer agrees to pay compensation for the entire service. And in case of construction company, which has completed its construction project in less than 2 years. So in all such instances, you don't have to pay compensation in the event of closure. So before we proceed to chapter 5b, let us see some questions and let me try to answer those questions. In the meantime, if any of you have got any more questions, you can keep typing the questions. The first question by P. Rao, he says, sir, can COVID-19 be treated as natural calamity? We have to, again, it is a matter of law, because if you clearly read the National Disaster Management Act, it does not specifically mention a pandemic or a epidemic should come under natural calamity. They are essentially, the very act, National Disaster Management Act, was enacted to deal with the natural calamities like flood, earthquake, and so on. But here, unfortunately, the government, both the central government and state government, is saying that under the Disaster Management Act, COVID-19 is treated as natural calamity. So since the government is saying so, let us now accept that it is true. It is subject to, again, the approval by the Supreme Court. Matter is already pending in Supreme Court. There are many organizations who have already filed cases in the Supreme Court. Another question by P. Rao, if we declare layoff from Monday to Saturday, that is alternate 6 days for some workmen and next week for some workmen, can we deduct Sunday and pay for only 12 days layoff compensation and 14 working days. Yes, you are right. You can do that because the layoff compensation definition clearly says for the days of holidays, you don't have to pay layoff compensation. Then Vikas Rajput has a question. If any employee can retrenchment company, I didn't get this question. Maybe Vikas may be trying to say, can we retrench any employee from the company? Yes, you can retrench any employee from the company by following the retrenchment procedure. That is the last come first go rules. That is the junior most employee should be retrenched first, followed by the other senior employees. Then Merin Jai has a question. What are the types of retrenchment that takes place in an organization? Generally, there is only one type of retrenchment, that is as provided under the Industrial Disputes Act. There are no other retrenchment. In other cases, let us say due to disciplinary reasons, if you are removing someone, it is called as dismissal. And therefore, let us say you are removing someone from service due to continuous unauthorized absence. We call it as termination simpliciter. Okay, so therefore, the retrenchment is of only one type. I hope there are no other questions. Yeah, there are few more. Junior most first retrenchment means position or service. Junior most first retrenchment means in each category, let us say you have, it is a question by Panchaksharaya. Junior most first retrenchment means, let us say you have different categories of employees in terms of their nature of work, their functions, or their qualifications. Let us say you have turner, fitter, mechanic, electrician, and so on. And let us say you want to remove only electricians. You have 20 electricians, out of which you require only 10 and you want to reduce the remaining 10. You want to retrench the remaining 10. Now, to see the seniority, you have to look at only the electricians, not the turner, fitter, or mechanic. These are rare instances, but in most cases, we don't go by that specific functions or qualifications. Rather, we go by the total employees. In case you are going by specific functions or for specific departments, in such a case, you look at the seniority of only those particular category of employees or only those particular group or departments or units. There is one more question by Srinivas Das, will these acts applicable in the time of national disaster management? Yes, the National Disaster Management Act are the orders so far issued under the National Disaster Management Act have not prohibited the employers from laying off their workers or from closing down their industrial establishments or from transferring the ownership of industrial establishment from your owner to some other owner. Okay. Only thing is, in all their communications, they have said, don't remove anyone from service and don't reduce their salaries. That is fine. I suppose you have not removed anyone from service. Only thing is, it is only a matter of time. In the days to come, there are employers who will challenge it in the court of law. And fortunately, in case court applies its mind, it can very well say that the National Disaster Management Act does not empower the government to insist the employer to pay salary. For example, from where will the employer pay the salary? See, if paying salary is that simple, then why can't government pay the salary? From where will the employer pay? See, for 10-15 days, fine. You declared a lockout on 24th of March. Let us say for next 10 days you paid. Most of the organizations have paid in the month of April also. From where does that money come? Now, if you want to continue paying the same salary for May, June and other months, from where will the money come basically? So, this is a matter of law which is to be decided by the court of law. My personal view is the National Disaster Management Act does not give powers to either central government or state government to insist the employer to continuously pay the salary even though the workplaces have been closed down and there is no production activities in the organization. A few more questions. Can partial layoff and then partial retrenchment can be done? What do you mean by partial? Let us say you have 100 workers. You don't want to lay off everyone. You want to lay off only 50 workmen. Or you have 100 workers. You don't want to retrench everyone. You want to retrench only, say, 25 or 30. Yes, partial layoff or partial retrenchment is allowed. There is a question by Ram Krishna. Can lay off contract workers also? See, for contract workers, why do you want to lay up and waste your money? You want to lay up contract workers and spend your money for paying lay up compensation to contract workers? See, reducing contract workers is very simple. Make a phone call to the labor contractor and say, from tomorrow, I do not require this 50 or 100 contract workers. He will withdraw them. What else you want? So why do you want to go for layoff and waste your money for layoff compensation to contract laborers? A question by Shiv. He says, what are the legal remedies available if union raises issue during layoff chapter 5A? See, under chapter 5A, generally the union should not raise any issue because under chapter 5A, you are going to give layoff without seeking government permission. So government cannot prevent you from laying off the workers under chapter 5A. Therefore, I don't see any difficulty to lay off under chapter 5A. Under chapter 5B, it will be difficult, which we are going to see right now. There is a question by anonymous attendee. Sir, we have 1,000 employees and 500 contract employees. Is it applicable for the retrenchment of contract employees? Again, I tell you whether it is layoff of contract employees or retrenchment of contract employees. You don't have to follow this because they are not your employees. So why do you want to retrench or why do you want to lay off them and spend your money for layoff compensation or retrenchment compensation? See, don't waste your company's money. Okay, they are not your employees. You just inform the labor contractor by saying that you don't want them in service. So he will withdraw them. A question by Ravi Rajan AR. He says, sir, but we have agreement with the contractor, either 1 month's notice period. So you have to give 1 month notice period and do it. Yes, if you have got such a notice, then you have to follow that notice. So you have to intimate the labor contractor 1 month in advance, and then you can ask him to withdraw. But at least now you have learned some lessons. In future, in your agreement, when you draft the agreement with the contractor, you have to incorporate a special clause that in the event of a natural disaster or an epidemic or pandemic, which is beyond the control of the employer, we will not be able to give 1 month's advance notice to remove the contract workers from service. So such a clause you can add. See, till now such things had not happened. A pandemic of COVID says we had not experienced. That's why this clause was not added. So in future agreements with the contractors, please do incorporate a special clause stating that in the event of unforeseen situations which are beyond the control of the employer, we will not be able to give 1 month notice. So without giving 1 month notice, the principal employer will have the right to remove the contract workers from service. There's a question by Balchandra. His question is, what are some reasons we can give to retrench employees? You can give any reasons other than misconduct. You cannot tell an employee that you have stolen the company property, or you have destroyed the company property, or you have misbehaved with your supervisor, therefore I am going to retrench you from service. Why you cannot give these reasons? Because all these reasons, either stealing the property, destroying the property, or slapping a supervisor or a co-worker, or let us say misbehaving with another employee, these are all misconduct for which you have to issue charge sheet, appoint an inquiry officer, conduct the inquiry. If the allegations are proved in the inquiry, then only you can dismiss him from service or remove him from service. For any other reason, let us say you want to reduce the cost, you can retrench an employee. You want to reduce the number of people, you can retrench an employee. You somehow don't see good performance on the part of this employee, you can retrench him. So for any other reasons, you can remove him. Let us say he is frequently absenting from work, he is a habitual absentee, you remove him from service. So for all such reasons, you can very well remove him. I hope I have answered all the questions. If there are no questions, can we move on to the next topic? Okay, three participants have raised the hand. At least I didn't understand what they mean by that. Can somebody tell me why they are raising the hand? Send a message. Okay, I hope there are no questions on chapter 5A. Let us move on quickly to chapter 5B. Having discussed the Chapter 5A of Industrial Disputes Act as regards layoff, retrenchment, transfer, and closure of undertaking, let us now move on to Chapter 5B. It is written as capital V dash capital B. For the sake of understanding, I have added here the numerical 5 also, so that it doesn't, you should not read it as VB. You have to read it as 5B. So here, again, the definition of industrial establishment is quite narrowed down. Please look at this definition. For this chapter, it is applicable only to a factory or to a mine or to a plantation employing not less than 100 workmen. It means to a factory or a mine or a plantation employing 100 or more workmen, only this chapter is applicable. For all other establishment, it is not applicable. For which are the establishment not applicable? Look at the other fines. It is not applicable to industries of seasonal or intermittent nature. It is not applicable to industries having less than 100 workmen. It is not applicable to other industrial establishments like transport organizations, retail organizations, information technology organizations, your BPO organization, hospitality industries, and so on. So under Chapter 5B, let us look at layup. What does the provisions of layup under Chapter 5B says? Section 25M of Industrial Dispute Act deals layup under Chapter 5B. According to Section 25M, the employer has to apply for permission of the government for layup. So this is the major difference in Chapter 5B. So for all these things, whether you want to lay up, whether you want to retrench, or whether you want to close down, in all the three instances, the employer has to seek permission. You don't have only in case of this thing. You are required to send 60 days advance notice for retrenchment and layoff under 5A. You are required to apply permission. Whereas 5B, that is the major difference. Or retrenchment or closure, you have to seek prior permission. It is not intimation. You have to make an application to the government, get permission from that is labor department. And then only you can go with the layup. I suppose, as of now, there are about 70 participants. I suppose most people represent the larger organizations, that is, organizations employing.
Sir.
Video bandu, audio bandu, va? Audio.
Sir, got connected. Now it's fine, sir.
Prior to this, we were discussing about under Chapter 5B of the Section 25M. So, according to the Section 25, to lay out the the employer has to seek prior permission of the labor department of the government. When
sir, your voice is not clear, sir. Now it's clear, sir. Yes, sir, it is audible.
Is it audible now?
Yes, sir, it is audible.
Okay, so as per section 25M, the employer has to apply for permission of the government to lay off its employees. When you make an application, a copy of the said application, the application you are sending to the government, that copy of the application you have to give to the concerned workman also, the workman whom you are going to lay off, for them also you have to give a copy.
When you make an application,
after going through your application, the government may either grant the permission or refuse to grant your permission. By looking into all facts and circumstances, the government will also call for a meeting. They will hear both the parties, you as well as the workman, or if workman have got a union, they will hear them. They will hear you, and finally they will decide whether to give permission for layoff or not. If government fails to communicate its decision, either to give layoff the permission or not to give permission within 60 days, then you can assume that permission is granted. The decision of the government in this regard, either to give permission or to refuse permission, is final, and it will be in force for a period of 1 year. So next 1 year it will be in force, you need not have to apply once again. But the government also has the power to review its own decision on its own or on an application made by either the employer or the application made by the workers, to relook at the decision and if necessary change the decision. So what is the government decision? Government may have permitted you to retrench, or it may have refused to give permission for layoff. The government may also refer the matter to industrial dispute for adjudication. Let us say if the government is of the view that there are few more important issues to be understood from this question of layoff, then it may refer this your application for layoff, it may refer it to the industrial tribunal. In such a case, the industrial tribunal will have to hear the matter very quickly and give its award or give its decision within 30 days. What is the consequence of layoff without prior permission under chapter 5B? Layoff without permission is illegal. Illegal in the sense, someone is punishable. Employer is punishable. Employer is punishable means what? You think your CEO will go to jail? No. Ultimately, it is you, HR manager, who will go to the jail. Okay. So therefore, remember, layoff without prior permission of the government is illegal. The second consequence, workmen are eligible for all the benefits as if they are not laid off. It means they will get full salary, they will get seniority, they will get benefit, the bonus or any other benefits if they had worked. So therefore, illegal layoff, that is layoff without government permission, is illegal, for which the employer will be punished. What is the punishment? We will see later on. The employer will be punished and the workman will be getting all the benefits, including full salary, as if they were not laid off. In certain circumstances, prior permission of the government is not required, or it can be waived to go for layoff under chapter 5B. The layoff is due to shortage of power or due to natural calamity. Let us say if you have to declare a sudden layoff, why? There is no electricity for the past one day, for the past 24 hours or for the past 2 days. You think in within one day or 2 days you are able to get permission from labor department to declare a layoff? Impossible. At least I can assure you, it requires at least 2 to 3 weeks for the labor department to look at your application. So therefore, when there is no electricity, how will you run the show? Or let us say there is any other problem like natural calamity, sudden flooding, or let us say accident or some other problem. So what will you do? In such a case, you may not be able to seek prior permission and government will waive that requirement. In case of a mine, the layoff is due to fire in the mine or flood in the mine or explosion or excessive inflammable gas. So in such cases also, you can give layoff without seeking government permission. The government has power to waive the permission in exceptional circumstances like death of the employer or accident in the factory. The government will have the power to waive the requirement of prior permission to go for layoff under Chapter 5B. Let us assume you have got permission from the government to lay off your workers under Chapter 5B. I repeatedly tell you Chapter 5A, 5B, so you should not get confused. Chapter 5B is applicable only to a factory or to a mine or to a plantation employing more than 100 workers. So it has very limited applicability to a factory or to a mine or to a plantation employing more than 100 workers. Okay. So the laid off workers are eligible for compensation in accordance with Section 25C. So Section 25C we had seen in Chapter 5A, which talks about lay off compensation at the rate of 50% of basic and DNS allowance. So here also the same rate of lay off layoff compensation you have to pay, that is 50% of the basic wages and DNS allowance has to be payable as layoff compensation. But here one difference is the layoff compensation has to be continued under Chapter 5B even if the layoff continues beyond 45 days, whereas under Chapter 5A, if the layoff continues beyond 45 days, you had the option to retrench the workers or you had the option to enter into an agreement to continue the layoff without paying the retrenchment compensation, layoff compensation beyond 45 days. But here, even if it continues beyond 45 days, you have to pay the layoff compensation. And there are certain instances where layoff compensation can be denied to a workman who was laid off. Which are they? If the employer offers alternative employment in the same establishments or another establishment of the same employer within 5 km distance, or if the new service conditions are not less favorable, it is not or, and both the conditions are required. So the employer offers alternative employment in the same establishment or another establishment of the same employer within 5 km distance, and if the new service conditions are not less favorable. So your employer is also saying that you are going to work from tomorrow in another factory owned by me and your salary or other terms and conditions are similar to what you are enjoying right now. And let us say after making these two offers, the employee refuses to go and work there. So in such a case, the employer can refuse to pay the layoff compensation. Okay, so this is all about layoff under Chapter 5B. The major difference here is Chapter 5B has a narrow difference, that is only for factories, mines and plantation employing more than 100 workers. For all other establishment, it is not applicable. And here, the other major difference is, even for layoff, the employer has to seek prior permission from the government and without permission, layoff becomes illegal. That is, employer is punishable. Now, let us move on to the next question. That is, next aspect. That is, retrenchment of workmen under Chapter 5B. Section 25N deals with retrenchment. So, what does this section 25N talks about? It says the workman should be in continuous service of the employer at least for 1 year to be eligible for retrenchment compensation. It means the workman who have rendered less than 1 year service can be removed from service without paying retrenchment compensation. I have already told you in Chapter 5A, retrenchment means termination of service of a workman. That is permanent cessation of employer-employee relation. Today, if you are retrenching a person, from tomorrow he is no more your employee. Okay. So prior permission of the government is required under Chapter 5B. For layoff also you require prior permission of the government. And for retrenchment also, you require prior permission of the government. Then, 3 months advance notice or 3 months salary in lieu of advance notice has to be paid to the workman. So, what was the condition under Chapter 5A? Under Chapter 5A, you were required to give only 1 month advance notice or 1 month salary in lieu of the notice period. Whereas, under Chapter 5B, the notice period or the salary in lieu of notice period is 3 months and not 1 month. The government, after considering all the facts and circumstances, may either grant the permission to go for retrenchment or refuse the permission and say that you should not go for retrenchment. If the government does not communicate its decision within 60 days, then you can presume that permission is granted. The decision of the government in this regard is final and binding on all the parties, and it will be valid for 1 year. So if you have got permission today for retrenchment, during next 1 year, you can do the retrenchment. Only if you are doing retrenchment after 1 year, you have to once again apply for the permission. The government on its own motion or an application by affected party may review its own decision, which it has either permitted or not permitted to go for retrenchment. The government also has the power to refer the matter to industrial tribunal for adjudication. In such a case, the tribunal should expeditiously hear the matter and give its award within 30 days. Retrenchment without permission is illegal, and affected workmen are entitled for all benefits as if they were not retrenched. Please remember the meaning of illegality. Illegality means if you are retrenching employees without seeking prior permission of the government, then that becomes illegal. It means employer is liable to be punished. We are going to see at the end what is the punishment to be given to the employer. And then the affected workmen are entitled for all salary and other benefits as if they were not retrenched, as if they were in continuous service. The government in exceptional circumstances may waive the requirement of prior permission. There may be exceptional circumstances where you had to remove employees from service. So in such a case, if you can make out a case and represent to the government, they may waive this requirement of prior permission. The retrenched workman shall be paid by the employer retrenchment compensation at the rate of 15 days average pay for every completed year of service, which is the same under Chapter 5A also. Okay, so far we have discussed under Chapter 5B, layoff and retrenchment. Now let us move on to the closure of industrial establishment under Chapter 5B. Section 25O deals with closure under Chapter 5B. Accordingly, the employer shall make an application 90 days in advance to the government seeking permission for closure. So, it is a prescribed form. If you go through the rules of Industrial Disputes Act, the rules, state rules under the Industrial Disputes Act, you will see all these things. If you are a mining organization, you have to look at the central rules. If you are any other organization, you have to look at your respective state rules. So prescribed forms are given as to in which form you have to apply for permission for any of these, whether it is layoff, retrenchment or closure. So here you have to make an application at least 90 days in advance, that is 3 months in advance. And when you make an application, simultaneously you have to give a copy of that application to the affected workmen who are going to be, lose their jobs due to closure of your industry or closure of your business. Prior permission is not required in case of construction industry. If you are a construction industry into building roads, bridges, tanks, dams and so on, and if you want to close down your business, for you, prior permission of the government is not required. Again, the government will look at all the facts and circumstances to decide whether to grant you or refuse the permission. If the government does not communicate its decision within 60 days, it is automatically presumed that permission is granted. It is deemed that permission is granted. The decision of the government is final and it will be binding on all the parties and it will be valid for a period of 1 year. The government on its own motion or on the application of the affected party may review its decision. The government may also refer the matter to industrial tribunal. In such a case, the tribunal shall hear the parties expeditiously and give its decision or award within 30 days. Remember, closure without permission is illegal and the affected workmen are entitled for all the benefits as if they were in service. Even though you have removed them service, I mean, you have closed down your undertaking and you have not got any work done from them. But let us say later on the tribunal decides that it is wrong, then you have to pay them all salary and benefits as if they were in service. The government in exceptional circumstances may waive the requirement of prior permission. If permission is granted or deemed to be granted, the workman shall be paid by the employer compensation at the rate of 15 days average pay for every completed year of service as per section 25F. Okay, let us move on to the illegality aspects and the penalty. See, we have already discussed for illegal layoff, illegal retrenchment and illegal closure, the benefits accruable to the workers. That is, the workers will get full salary and all other benefits as if their service was continued. Okay, now I told you illegality also calls for punishment. Now come here to the punishment. For illegal layoff, that is layoff without prior permission of the government, or illegal retrenchment, that is retrenchment without prior permission of the government, the employer will be punished with imprisonment up to 1 month and penalty up to 1,000 rupees or both. Of course, the punishment looks very insignificant, 1 month only. But look at the image or reputation of your CEO or your managing director. You want him to go to jail for this? Even if it is payment of just 1,000 rupee penalty, he feels hurt, he feels insulted. He may question the HR manager by saying that, why at all did you do this? Why you did not follow the rule of law? So therefore, my suggestion to you is, you as a HR manager should be an expert on all these things and it is your duty to guide the management how to go about a lawful layoff or a lawful retrenchment or a lawful closure. Next, the punishment for illegal closure, imprisonment up to 6 months and penalty up to 5,000 rupees are both. Okay, so here the punishment is very high for closure, illegal closure, compared to the punishment for illegal layoff and illegal retrenchment. So here, I will stop my discussion and let us see if I have to take any questions. I don't know if there are If there are any other questions, please do raise your question.
Sir, can you able to hear me, sir?
Okay, here is a question by Arshad. Can we terminate or retrench a pregnant employee? My question to you in turn is, don't do that, because there is another law. A pregnant employee may have been covered under ESI Act or Maternity Benefit Act. I have been receiving calls from the distressed women from time to time from across the country that she was about to go on maternity leave in next 2 to 3 months time, and in order to deprive her the maternity benefit. Nowadays maternity benefit is quite big, that is 6 months full salary. If she is covered under ESA, fine. But most often they are not covered under ESA because their salary is more than 21,000 per month. As a result, the liability falls on the employer to pay 6 months salary as maternity benefit, and therefore most often employers insist that she has to resign on her own, otherwise they will make some false allegations against her of misconduct and she will be dismissed from service. So such, due to such threats, many people do. My suggestion is, don't terminate or don't retrench a pregnant employee. There is, I think Arshad has once again typed, but there are no questions. P. Rao has another question. Sir, if there is no union, can we directly put notice and lay off? Under section and under chapter 5A, yes, whether there is a union or no union, you can do the lay off. But under section, under chapter 5B, even if there is no union, you have to seek prior permission of the government. Only after getting permission you can do the layoff. One more question by P. Rao. Sir, how to treat unleave in case of layoff? So in case of layoff, all the unleave has to be given encashment. Even if there is a prorata unleave, not fully, let us say he or she has worked only for 6 months, I would suggest you to calculate the number of earned leave and give that pro rata also. If there is a gratuity or any other benefit, calculate everything and credit it to their bank account immediately. Because if you don't do any of those things, even the smaller amounts of money can create you legal problem if the employee challenges your decision in the court of law. Is transportation facility to be given for layoff workmen to come and sign the layoff register? This is an important question. Let us say you have laid off, but you only want him to come every day and sign. I would suggest either you provide him transportation, otherwise you say that you don't come every day, once in 15 days or once in a month you come and sign. If you want him to come and sign every day, I would suggest you provide him transportation, otherwise how will he come? There is no format of register. Your regular muster roll, your attendance register, let us say if your attendance is automated and for laid up workmen you don't allow them to mark their attendance there, then you keep any other manual attendance notebook. In the stationery shop, attendance books are available. Keep it with the security in the entrance. When the laid off workman comes there, in the security cabin, he will sign the layoff register and go back. Another question by P. Rao. Sir, in case of closure, if we have two units manufacturing same product, can we close one unit? Is we are liable to offer them job in another unit? If you are closing down, it is at the option of the employer to give employment in another unit. If employer thinks that I don't want to give the retrenchment benefit, particularly if you are a unionized company, it is not that simple. getting permission from the government is extremely difficult, either for layoff or retrenchment or closure. Extremely difficult. So therefore, it is good if you can offer employment, fine. If you don't want to offer employment, it is up to you as an employer. But you offer employment, the place of employment should be within 5 kilometer radius. In case it is away beyond 5 kilometers and the employee still wants to relocate and work there, then you offer him. But offering employment in another unit or not offering employment in another unit is totally left to the employer, and the workman cannot insist that if there is no vacancy in this factory, you send me to that factory, don't remove me from service. There is a question by anonymous attendee. What about the compensation for employees under probation period in the event of closure of industry? If they have not rendered 1 year continuous service, you don't have to pay compensation to an employee under probation. Generally, in all manufacturing industries, the probation period is 6 months. In some cases, you may have extended this probation period by another 6 months, or let us say another 7 or 8 months. By that way, you may have already completed, let us say, more than 12 months or more than a year as a probationer. He continues to be probationer. So in such a case, you have to pay him compensation. If he has, even though he is a probationer, he has completed more than 1 year of continuous service, you have to pay him compensation. A question by Sunil Nair. Can you please share the PPT on mail? Let me speak to our listing sponsors, the M&HR Solutions. In case they have captured your email ID or any other contact details, they should be able to arrange sending these PPTs to you. At least I have no issue on copyrights. But let me talk to Mr. Ramesh of M&HR Solutions and explore the possibility. Those of you who want PPTs, please share your WhatsApp numbers or email IDs to Ramesh, the organizer of this event. Okay, and there is a compliment from P. Rao. Next, Balchandra has a question. What are some reasons we can give to retrenched employees? Give any reasons other than a reason of misconduct. I already told you in the past, don't give reasons like you have stolen property, you have misbehaved with another employee, and so on. They are all misconduct for which you have to issue charge sheet and conduct disciplinary action. So here you have to give any other reason. Let us say your performance is not up to the mark. That could be one reason. You are very irregular to the work. We are not making enough profit, or your salaries are very high, therefore we want to reduce the cost of operations. Give any other reasons. In any case, the reason should not be related to indiscipline. If it is indiscipline, you have to issue charge sheet, prove the allegation, then only you can remove him from service. Other than the reasons of indiscipline, you can give any other reasons. Okay, I get some this thing here that 4 people have raised hand. I am not able to understand the meaning of raising hand, whether they have a question or something else. They have to type the message as to why they are raising the hands. Are there any other questions? If there are no other questions, then probably I request Mr. Ramesh of M&HR Solutions Private Limited to take over and conclude the session.
Am I audible, sir?
Ramesh, are you here?
Yeah, I can hear you, sir, but my voice is not clear to the participants. Can anyone ping me in the message so that I can able to conclude the session? Okay. Finally, we are at the end of the session. My name is Ramesh, Director of M&HR Solutions and also Secretary for Niratanka Trust. So this is the first free session organized by M&HR, and this time I would like to thank
ಜ್ವರ ಕೆಮ್ಮು ಅಥವಾ ನೆಗಡಿ ಅಂತಹ ಲಕ್ಷಣಗಳು ಇದ್ದರೆ
Ramesh, are there any other question? I don't see any other question. Can we conclude now?
Yes, sir. I will conclude. I am giving the vote of thanks.
Okay.
Already it is.
Go ahead.
Time is over. Okay. Okay, sir. I will conclude.
Okay.
Thank you. Sorry, first of all, I would like to apologize for the technical error in the beginning. At the same time, I am not able to reciprocate properly. And also in the initial stage, we got some technical errors. And I did not able to introduce Dr. G.P. Nayak. After hearing Dr. G.P. Nayak, it's my duty and gratitude to introduce him at the final stage. Dr. G.P. Nayak, we have with us. He is closely associating with M&HR Solutions Private Limited and Niratanka. He is also my mentor and guide. Dr. G.P. Nayak is a professor of HRM and labor legislation and experienced trainer in HR domain. He is a doctorate in management from Kenara School of Management Studies, Bangalore University. Previously, he was the head of learning and development at Carle Group of Companies, Bangalore. He is a graduate in law and has handled more than 100 employee discipline cases in his previous organizations. He has provided training and consultancy services to several reputed organizations like Karnataka Employers Association, International Labor Organization, Labor Department of Government Karnataka, Indo-Nissan, and other many MNC companies. So finally, today's session, more than 80 participants participated, and also more than many of the HR professionals watched Facebook Live and also watching now. So finally, I would like to thank Dr. G.P. Nayak on behalf of M&HR Solutions and Niratanka and on behalf of all the participants. And many are asking for the PPT of today's session. Definitely, we'll try to share the PPT if you all provide email IDs. And also, finally, we have a Google group. Around 8,000 HR professionals are connected all over India. We'll also try to add, if you send your email IDs to that Google group. And in furthermore, many more sessions we are planning to organize the similar kind of a sessions. Definitely, you keep connected. And follow our LinkedIn or Facebook or through our website. You can visit to our website and you can join to our online groups. Thank you one and all. And finally, I thank Dr. G.P. Nayak once again. Goodbye. Thank you.